Hello and welcome. You're watching NewsX. This is the big day, February 1, the mega budget that has been announced, and all the focus has been garnered over the renewal of the tax slabs. Yes, we had seven tax slabs back in the day. They've been turned to five. Let's quickly take a look at what these five revised tax slabs are. And I'm going to once again repeat this. There are new income tax slabs that have been brought forth in those under the income of 0 to 3 lakh. Earlier, they had to end up paying a tax of 2,500. Their tax now reduces to zero, and therefore their essential savings are at 2,500. Quickly taking a look at the next tax slab of 3 lakh to 6 lakh rupees. Earlier, they ended up paying taxes worth 22,500. Their tax now reduces to 15,000 rupees and their savings are at 7,500 rupees. Let's quickly take a look at the third tax slab from 6 lakh to 9 lakhs. They earlier ended up spending 60,500 rupees. Their tax now is at 45,000 rupees. It essentially helps them save 15,000 rupees. So that's disposable income in their pocket for the income group of 6 to 9 lakhs. From 9 lakh up to 12 lakh, that's the earlier tax slab. That's the current tax slab. They ended up paying the government 1,15,000 rupees. Their current tax at this time 90,000. Savings, a considerable amount of it at 25,000 rupees. And quickly, from 12 to 15 lakhs, let's take a look at the tax slab here. That's the 12 to 15 lakh tax slab. The tax earlier they ended up paying was 1,87,500 rupees. They currently pay a reduced tax of 1,50,000 rupees, and they end up saving 37,500 rupees. And finally, those who have an income of 15 lakh rupees and more, quickly shifting our focus, they ended up paying a tax of so we'll also take a look at that. There's a 30% change in the 30% of the income is to be paid by those who end up getting an income of 15 lakh rupees. Quickly getting in Atul Puri to give me a comprehensive analysis of the tax slabs that have been reduced from 7 to 5. How does this impact the common man? How does it impact the middle class? Does this also hit on the receipts that the government earns, maximum of them, from income tax that is generated out of the middle class? Atul, go ahead.
Yeah, okay. So, thanks. Basically, see, the change in the tax slab is basically only for individuals who qualify under the new regime. So, those who are under the old regime, for them, it continues to remain the same with no changes in their tax slabs. So, one needs to be clear with this concept that the change is only for those individuals who fall under the new regime. So, why this change? What I could understand, obviously, I need to go through the fine prints as of now. But what I could understand is that the success of the scheme was not that as was expected by the ministry in the previous budget. So that is why, in order to make it, because we did our mathematics in the previous budget, and anybody who is above a salary income of about 10 to 12 lakh rupees would is more beneficial if it goes with the old regime rather than the new regime. This is in the last budget. So in order to make it more popular, the new regime, that is why these new slabs have been introduced, and the number of slabs with the number of reduced rates has been further staggered. So that actually adds more popularity to the new regime, and it will also leave more money in the pocket of those salaried employees. So it's a good news for the salaried employees, because this will reduce their tax liability, which they have to otherwise offload out of their income. So yes, that's the main purpose under the new regime. The change is only for those who are individuals who qualify for this.
Mm-hmm. I'm quickly going to remind my viewers that on the bottom of your screens, you can actually see the phone number for NewsX. So if you want to call and speak about this revised change in terms of the tax slabs, whether this actually impacts your income, how does this impact it, why do you feel that this is a good move, if at all you feel it's a good move, well, it's going to be a good move because you're going to get the disposable income in your pockets to be able to spend it, expend it. I'm quickly going to also get another panelist on the discussion. With me, I have Anshul Gupta. He's the MD Okaya EV. Anshul, more money in the pockets of individuals of the middle class. That's good news because the circulation of funds then increases to allow for new infusion of money into the system.
Absolutely. I totally agree with that. And it definitely helps promote, you know, the green initiative also, as the Prime Minister sort of focused on how the green economy, green growth is going to be of utmost importance. So enabling people to have that extra saving in their bank account will actually help them shift to electric vehicles as well faster. That is my personal opinion on that.
Okay. All right. So if you will be able to put that chunk of money to be able to buy that new EV car, well, that's where the Prime Minister, that's where the Finance Minister is looking to bring your focus among several other things. And this is obviously a budget that has come with quite the bang since the pandemic hit, which ended up increasing our fiscal deficits. But talking about fiscal deficits, it has further increased to about 5.9%, if I'm not wrong. And the finance minister has spoken that it is going to be her renewed focus to reduce that fiscal deficit in 2024-25 to about 4.5-4.6%. Getting in with me, Ms. Lakshmi Venkatraman. Now speaking about fiscal deficit, speaking about the receipts that government gets, 27 lakh crore rupees, but talking about the expenditure, the public expenditure has risen to about 41.9 lakh crore rupees from the 39.5956 lakh crores that was in 2022-2023. How is the 41.90 lakh crore rupees going to be expended? There has already been allocation made to MSMEs, allocation made to green hydrogen, allocation that has been made to skill development, allocation made to fisheries under the Matsya scheme by the government, by the finance ministry. Where else is money going in?
The money is going absolutely into the areas that needs that kind of stimulus. As you correctly said, it is going into MSMEs. It is certainly going into new technology. It is going into research. It is also going into the hands of farmers, and it is going into the hands of startups. Mm-hmm. So in every which way, if you look at it, it is going into the hands of those people who will actually contribute to the growth of this economy. Because at any point in time, every country has to make some kind of a balance between the growth and fiscal deficit versus what is it that is needed to stimulate the economy. And remember, we are all coming out globally, even we are coming out of the pandemic, which has been an extremely difficult situation. And in that context, I believe that the finance minister has wisely upped the spending. So, and this has been a budget for everyone. Mm-hmm. All 360 degree angle of the Indian economy is being taken care
okay.
of. So okay. In that sense, it's very wise.
Okay, I'm quickly going to interrupt you there because I'm being joined by a caller. Shekhar, he's calling me for Sikandrabad. Shekhar, your comment particularly on the tax slabs that have been revised from 7 to 5, how does it impact your salary particularly?
Medical benefit, ATC, ATD. On that.
Okay, could you repeat that? Could you repeat that query so that we can propose it to my panelists?
Claim medical insurance and other things.
Okay, you're wrong about medical insurance amongst other things. ATC, Atul, would you like to respond to that?
Yeah, so sir,
go ahead, Atul.
So I got your question. See, as far as the update which we have is basically for ATC, there is no change as of now. There was a strong push which was to enhance the limit, because 1.5 lakh rupees is too short a limit, and considering the per capita income increase, it was expected that this number will increase by in this budget. Unfortunately, there has been no change, so I'm sorry for that. So maybe we have to wait for the next fiscal budget to come in again.
Okay, there you have it. I hope Shekhar from Sikandrabad, your question, your query has been answered. Coming back to Anshuman Joshi. Now we've spoken about money that has been provided at the in the hands of the people to dispose of, to expend. This is going to allow for an increased, how does that impact inflation? We are at a bad, I mean, a relatively bad phase of some 10%, 11% inflation. Will this further worsen it?
No, I think this is going to eventually make it better because, you know, I think this budget is moreover about driving in. I mean, this budget is not something that you know, people are expecting. Let's say, for example, some people may be expecting that we will get a lot of freebies. So let me explain to you how this is going to really work out. Now, with all this money that is going into the right sectors, let's say a lot of it is going into the cooperative now after the new cooperation ministry has basically started off, you know, and it kicked off with some major legislative changes. For example, the Banking Regulation Amendment Act came in 2020. Now we have further amendments coming in the Banking Regulation Act. We have amendment coming in the Reserve Bank of India Act, which is a major change, you know, in order to ensure that, you know, the policies, the rules are, in to make sure they're in line to the common people. Now, let me explain to you. I'm sure you must have seen this, that the Honorable Prime Minister had increased the insurance from 1 lakh to 5 lakh. So that basically what happens is this, if a bank goes down, so in a period of 90 days, you get your money. But, you know, there has been challenges like, you know, if your money, you know, if your deposits are more than 5 lakhs, then you literally get stuck up for like 10 years, you keep on waiting. Okay. So basically what is going to really happen with these legislative changes is that basically this is going to make, you know, make the common people not suffer. And I am glad and very thankful to the Honorable Finance Minister and the government. They've come out with a budget that is really helping everybody out.
All right. Bairani Kumar also on the telecast with me. We're talking about the tax slabs. We're talking about giving some relief to the middle class. It's not a lot. But for the first time in the last 9 years of Prime Minister Narendra Modi and the NDA taking power, is there been a reshuffle for the tax slabs and relief to the middle class person?
Right. Well, I think it's a welcome move because I kind of come from the IT industry, so I can just talk from an IT industry perspective. I would say that more than 50% of the employees, right, are going to be benefited with this, the new regime, the tax slabs that have been announced, right, and the reduction in the percentages of tax. So I think it's definitely a good move. And as the other panelists mentioned, more money in the hands of people will only...
I think you've gotten muted. I'd ask you to unmute yourself so that we can hear you. Okay, there's bad connection. So continuing, yeah. Can you hear me, Bairani Kumar? Okay,
we're gonna. Yes, I can.
Okay, go ahead. What was the point that you were making? Yes, money in the hands of the people. How does that allow for the economy to further grow?
Yeah, absolutely. I think there should be more money in the system, and the economy grows only when there's a spend. Obviously, money transactions happen, and as it happens, I think there's also a little risk of increasing the inflation too. I think it should be a good balance. I think the range, right, from whatever up to 20 lakhs, I think that's a good range for middle class, people to be able to get benefited.
Okay.
In my opinion, I think it's a good move.
Okay. So also getting a response from you when it comes to the MSME sector, the skill development that has been the major focus area, impetus has been put by the government. How does that translate into creation of jobs?
Absolutely. The great question. So I think skilling has been given a primary focus here in this budget because, I will always say to anybody, India is becoming the office of the world, which means we are going to be the powerhouse of talent for the rest of the world. With that said, we need to constantly keep upskilling and reskilling ourselves, right? And we have a great advantage of demography. Having said that, lots of education institutions and the kind of people that are coming out have to be reskilled and upskilled. So with that said, this new program on upskilling and the very aggressive plan of about almost 3 lakh people to be trained in the next couple of years, or rather, in the next 3 years, many lakhs of people have to be trained in the areas of robotics, AI, and all those different aspects, right? I think it's a very welcome move because unless otherwise we prepare the youth towards, the new evolving technologies and skills, we will not be able to cope up with the Changing demands in the marketplace.
Yeah, that's an important point you raise. You know, skilling when it comes to AI, robotics, drones, AR, VR, that's also been the focus area of the government this time around. Firoz joins me on the telecast. He's a caller. He's a viewer. Firoz from Kashmir joins me. Firoz, what's your question? What's your query?
Good afternoon, madam. My question is that I want to know about, from the experts, about the tax rebate and tax exemption. What is the difference between the tax exemption and tax rebate?
Okay, so Atul, let's write in your lane, tax exemption versus tax rebates.
Yeah, so basically, Firozi, the tax exemptions are those income which is actually exempted from subject to tax. So there are certain incomes, like we have Section 10, which defines the exempted income. So which is not taxable in the hands of the individual or that income tax assessee. For example, like agriculture income is an exempted income. So that is not to be subject to tax in India, which has been there from the inception. Now, tax rebates are those which are otherwise taxable, liable to tax, but they are basically given as under certain provisions of the tax laws. They are allowed to be deducted from the taxable income, so that you don't have to pay that additional tax on it. So that's the primary difference between an exempted income and a rebate which is given under the provisions of tax.
Okay, great. I hope Firoz's query has been answered well by Atul. And you know, while we speak about the specifics, I'm going to again get Anshuman back on the telecast. I have with me Anshuman Joshi. Yes,
yes.
Right. I'm going to talk about green energy and the specific push of the government over the Prime Minister pet project, which is the green hydrogen. And there have been plants that are going to be set up. There are the Adanis and the Ambanis that have put in great amount of funds in it. There are set up of plants that are going to take place in Africa. There are Norway-India collaborations and cooperation that is taking place. How long the gestation period for the results to be seen?
Well, I personally feel it is a phenomenal concept to work on. And I think especially the EVs, the electronic vehicles, is something which is picking up pace now. So if you look at majority of the automobile companies, they're coming up with some of the other models for their brands to eventually go ahead and try and test the market. Now, you'd also see a lot of places that, the Honorable Minister of Roads and Mr. Nitin Gadkari, he eventually himself had launched an electronic vehicle and the hydrogen fuel. And basically, this is something which they're promoting with a fabulous budget and contribution towards the sector. I personally feel that's the future, because after all, till how long do you think we should be basically dependent on the diesel and the petrol? How long do you think we should be dependent on these oils? Mm-hmm. After all, there's an end to it. So I think the best is going green.
Going green and talking about the last mile connectivity. And going green and the last mile connectivity by way of railway, by way of roads, by way of air connectivity, regional air connectivity was what the focus was for the government of India, for the finance ministry. And Lakshmi, how can we envisage sustainable cities? How can we envisage last mile connectivity, ensuring that there is sustainable growth, sustainable last mile connectivity as well?
Last mile connectivity is an important, not only from just the infrastructure, whether we go all the way, but also in terms of how do you involve, that's why the Prime Minister had created this LIFE. How do you get the citizens involved? How do you get local businesses involved? So while there has been a very good impetus in this budget for green technologies, it would be good to see now the corporates and others who are going to get into it to include the MSMEs as part of the supply chain and the value chain. When you do that, you push that green agenda all the way down to the local level in terms of both the entrepreneurs and the small businesses and the MSMEs, but you also involve all the citizens in it. So sometimes you look at the last mile connectivity not necessarily as just the infrastructure, the road, the railways, mm-hmm. but also in terms of the people and the involvement of the people.
And so therefore, you spoke about the districts and the villages and
yes.
then reaching up to the block development.
Yes.
And that's the impetus.
That is
that's
where
the
that
goal.
Link has to happen.
Yes, that's okay. All right. I have a caller with me, Spash. Spash, where are you calling from and what's your query? If you're able to hear me, Spash. Okay, there seems to be a bad audio connection there. Spash, I would request you to call us back again and pose your query. But in the meantime, Bharani Kumar a role in terms of the last mile connectivity by way of augmentation of railways, good connectivity by way of roads, as well as regional air connectivity. There's also a big aspect that has been touched by the government, that is tourism, and allowing for tourism to be increased in the border villages, border states. That says a lot about our security, our strategic areas that need to be focused on in wake of all that we have been witnessing over the past few years, last couple of two years, particularly on the northern frontier. Bharani Kumar, if you are able to hear me.
Can I answer that?
Okay, while we
yes.
try it, So I was asking about tourism and how the push for Northeast, look east, act northeast, is further being influenced by way of building tourism in northeastern states, northeastern villages.
Absolutely. So, you know, we all know that the northeastern economy is primarily dependent on tourism as well, right? In addition to the other, you know, farming aspects. But I think the regional air connectivity is a very good push, because I think people can afford traveling in the air right now. We see the kind of passengers traveling domestically or internationally is kind of increasing leaps and bounds in India. And it's becoming very affordable for every common person to travel in the air. I think the regional connectivity in general, and also specifically to Northeast, will certainly boost their local economy. I mean, in addition to tourism, it will certainly improve the livelihood of the people who are there, and also create a lot of, you know, like say, awareness on the overall ecosystem for the rest of the people, and also understand the culture. I think it will just boost in many different ways.
Yeah.
I really welcome that regional air connectivity impetus and the investments in that area.
Anshuman, talking about tourism and talking about creating these excellence centers, creating these unity malls, allowing for physical connect but also digital connect, that has been the push for the government ever since 2014 when the NDA government came to power. How can these be developed? You know, one district, one product, encouraging our handicrafts are put at the front and center when it comes to tourism, when it comes to whether domestic tourists or international tourists traveling across these countries, or picking up these 30 and 40 promotional centers across the country, and then making sure that they are made into world-class tourism hubs.
So let me answer that. So what's happening is this. First of all, I'd like to congratulate the Honorable Tourism Minister, who's been actually working on it for quite a while, and I personally am aware of that. So let me tell you this. There's a major change after the post the pandemic. So I also run some 11 travel portals in the international markets.
Mm-hmm.
So considering that, you know, I see that, you know, on a daily basis, there's a lot of traffic which is coming to India. A lot of people, a lot of foreigners, a lot of Indians, NRIs, everybody's coming to India. So I'm talking about Delhi as one of the most busiest airports in the world. Okay, so you can see the transformation already, even though we've been through a pandemic situation. And then I also want you to know that the tourism ministry has come out with fabulous schemes for entrepreneurs, businessmen, you know, and specifically who are into the tourism sector, you know, to create infrastructure, tourism related infrastructure, ecotourism. And also the states eventually have to come up with a pretty good, you know, marketing plan for marketing all the areas that they've got in their states, tourism, you know, spots that they've got, and which they're doing, just like the Incredible India program. They're working on it. So every state is working on it. Yeah.
Okay. Yes. Yes. You want to make a point?
I just want to pitch in for a technical change, which is related to this in the tax laws only, so that it is there in the knowledge of your viewers, basically.
Yeah.
So there is a provision of leave encashment, which was last amended in the year 2002, and the limit was 3 lakh rupees for that.
Mm-hmm.
This in this budget, our Honorable Finance Minister has increased that limit from 3 lakh rupees to 20 lakh rupees, which means there is more indispensable income available in the hands of the employees, which can be spent on various activities related to travel, tourism, or holidaying activities. You know.
Yeah,
you so know, I think that was important to bring in this discussion.
And it all binds all the impetuses and all the focus areas and schemes and the yojanas in the financial budget 2023-2024 with the disposable income that an individual will have, and therefore the direct taxes that have been at this time revised and reduced. I'm also being joined by Srinivasan Belagavi. He's joining me from Karnataka. You know, there has been a SOP that has been provided for Karnataka as well to fight the drought over there, and there has been a considerable amount of chunk that has been put out by the government of India, by the finance ministry. Srinivasan, what's your question?
Good morning to everybody. I have a micro industry, and many of us have a small clarification. Actually, when we export, there is something called LUT, the letter of undertaking, which exempts us from paying IGST at the time of export. Now, the LUT is online and it requires two witnesses. That is very, very strange, because that is something where, you know, first of all, you have to get two witnesses to do that, and it doesn't make any sense. If that is removed, then just like we have our self-assessed affidavits and all, then it will be very, very good. I just want to know the opinion of the experts there. Thank you.
Okay.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.